Greetings, everyone. This is Rock and Roll Spock Image with the Weekly Comic Book Roundup. We've covered this most of this tomorrow, but we sound to wrap things up. We'll kick things off with Star Wars Darth Vader number 28. Where we left off, Vader and Sabe had learned that the Imperial Governor destroying device they deactivated had actually been ordered to go through with experiments on it by the Emperor himself. So, Vader, after his injuries after his injuries and taking and going after Imperial Governor Tataza, Vader is healing in a Bacta tank. Upon getting out, Sabe is still present. And Vader's surprised to see her. But though she says that he made her a commander, she's there to serve. But she said she's an advisor, also claims to be an advisor, and so Vader asks her advice. And she suggests that Vader do what he's always done, confront the problem directly. And so, Vader and Sabe go to Coruscant, confront the Emperor. But the Emperor, you know, yeah, it's not like he's a fighter or anything, but Vader doesn't help her, and but she ends up fighting off two of the Royal Guards, so it does seem as though the Emperor inadvertently kills said guards. But rather than have her killed, the Emperor says, you know, yeah, you're molding her. You know, teach the Queen's Shadows, and tells her, and he's ordered to teach the Queen's Shadows to the Empire. They have new orders, however. They're to go to Skako Minor, which was the Techno Unit, the headquarters of the Techno Union. Upon arrival, there's a crashed freighter. This is when a commercial transport from Corellia was boarded without warning. The atmosphere is poisonous off-worlders, so everyone on board died with the moments of the hull breach. That said, the an upstart nationalist is trying to reclaim Skako Minor. That nationalist being Joel Tambor, grandson of Watt. And he's enlisted pirates to blockade the planet and stockpile technology of all kinds. But Vader and Sabe, upon landing, discover some pirates dealing with cliff worms. Most of them are dispatched by Vader. The last one escapes, and Sabe suggests that, you know, they're not going to find Tambor. They kill everyone who might know where he is. Vader tells Sabe to follow the speeder, infiltrate the organization, and find Joel Tambor. On Naboo, Ochi of Bestoon is being interrogated by a group of shadowy figures about Sabe. The figures are revealed to be none other than the other handmaidens. And they are bound to save their sister or stop her, no matter what it takes. That is where the issue ends. As we barrel towards the beginning of Return of the Jedi, the Star Wars comics are definitely getting even more interesting. Moving on to our next book, we've got The Crypt of Shadows. This is Marvel's Halloween special. It's a collection of, we've got a handful of stories, all narrated by the mirror-bound ghost of Doctor Strange. Our first story features features Blade's daughter on her way to a Halloween party, but she heard about a haunting in the area she was in, so she checked that out right quick. A couple of kids are seemingly summoning a spirit. They drop their phone with the ritual, however, and it apparently has an invocation of restraint. They've been trying to bind the spirit to the building. The two leave, and Brielle talks with the ghost. Apparently, he lives in that neighborhood for much of his entire life, and he waits now for his wife to join him. Our next story is called Werewolf by Moon Knight. So the new Werewolf by Night has been invited, is in New York, and he has been invited to a Halloween party. Apparently, he was invited by another werewolf who wished to have Jake, the new werewolf, be his second. Though his butler is well aware of this, and yeah, the servant and Jake duke it out when Moon Knight shows up, saving Jake and dealing with the other vampire and tying his body to the fence of the mansion with a sign saying "dirtbag" hanging off of him. The werewolf sees this and swears that this will be the last time Moon Knight gets in his way. Our next story focuses on Vittoria Montesi, who used to lead a group called the Darkhold Redeemers, and was busy trying and spent her time trying to basically get everything undo all the horrors that have been unleashed from within the Darkhold. But she has a nightmare of Morbius attacking her. Wakes up and goes to find him. Morbius is attacking a guy who is about to victimize a woman in an alleyway, but he starts seeing these strange bugs. When Victoria shows up, apparently he's dealing with creatures known as Troids. Transdimensional chthonic vermin. Semi exist trapped under our skin until our bonds against one another sets them free. But someone put a spell on him to awaken them. However, it turns out that he has a Troid queen inside. Turns out that the spell was cast by none other than Jinx, Louise Hastings' grandson. Louise Hastings was a member of the Darkhold Redeemers as well, who was killed by Morbius while Morbius was possessed by a demon. But everything is somewhat worked out by the end. Victoria, Jinx, and Morbius are all among the land, upright and able to go their own ways. But apparently the idea was to get revenge. Was Jinx's idea was to get revenge on Morbius for killing his grandmother. And then we've got a story featuring Elsa Bloodstone. There's a monster roaming in New York from the end of October. Journeys in the sewers. And runs into Johnny Storm. Apparently a... A pharmaceutical company hired Elsa to deal with the results of a clinical trial gone wrong. Turns out Spider-Man has been exposed to this, and Johnny's trying to help him. So Johnny and Elsa team up to save Spidey, and yeah, day is saved. Finally, we have The Endless Slaughter in the Infinite Swamp. Wolverine, Laura Kinney, versus Man-Thing. So for... She went to Man-Thing to... Apparently, this is a completely non-canonical story, though. She went to Man-Thing to ask for assistance against whatever... The you know, planet-ending disaster of the week. However... She'd never been downwind from Man-Thing before, and the pheromonal panoply of unearthly compounds and swamp mutagens wafting off of him was a perfect biological analog for Wolverine's trigger scent. And so the two of them begin an unending bat duel with one another. To the point where eventually Laura began killing Man-Thing to eat him, and well, Man-Thing would reconstitute himself and gets all the way up to year 100 million of this, and that is where the issue ends. I love a good Halloween special, so, and this was definitely no exception. I especially like the Elsa Bloodstone story just because it's nice to see Elsa interact with other heroes. Especially some of the more traditionally minded heroes. Also, the Moon Knight story was great. It was nice. One, it was nice seeing Jake Gomez again. And I'm hoping that maybe the events, the story might bleed into future Moon Knight story arcs. Moving on to our next book, we've got Midnight Suns number 2. From where we left off, a student at Strange Academy, Zoe Laveau, and a whole bunch of others had a vision of a coming apocalypse. Every magic user did it, at least, and potentially also Wolverine. So they've all, the ones who were actually in the vision have come together at Strange Academy, because Zoe is at the heart of it. So you start off with a flashback to Trancia in the 15th century. A coven led by Agatha Harkness is summoning forth a demon. In the present, Agatha Harkness has brought Zoe to the Trancian Harkness estate. Back at Strange Academy, the Midnight Suns, as it were, are dealing with Doom. Sister Grimm is feeling kind of useless, as she's long ago sent her the Staff of One into space, so she can't really do much. But she manages to find a weapon and an axe that can cut through anything. Agatha explains the demon This particular demon is Valtor, as in the vapors of Valtor, the spell Dr. Strange often uses. It's explained that the coven made invoked a demon named Valtor, and was granted 100 generations of sorcerers the use of its powers. Each time Valtor was entreated, the gifts were freely, but if you learned it, but magic is never free, there's always a cost. A little wisp of Valtor's power can be so overwhelming and corrosive. Imagine what Valtor could do if invited to Earth. But, Doom handles himself fairly well against the Midnight Suns. However, a new combatant arrives. Clea, the Sorcerer Supreme, who is not happy with the Midnight Suns for the damage they caused to the Strange Academy, and sends them to the Dark Dimension. Though it is pointed out that all of these heroes were in the Vision, so perhaps the idea is to change events by removing the five heroes. That is where the issue ends. And the comic's all right. I mean, I'm kind of getting the feeling that the setup is good. The game setup is basically going to be that no, it didn't. In fact, it made things, not having them there made things worse. So yeah, moving on to our next book, we've got Alien Number 2, where we left off. A squad of artificial humans had been enlisted to go to a heavily irradiated world named Toller 9 to get some potentially world-saving research materials for the company. So they arrive. They take in the sites. Some of the artificial humans looking at the architecture. They go into a basic linked network system of communication, but the xenomorph egg they were tasked to get is gone. But it seems there are it looks like various attempts at hybridizing the xenomorph with other races, with other beings. They journey through the complex and end up in the hive, and are actually attacked by xenomorphs. Though, them being artificial humans, they're able to deal with these xenomorphs rather easily. But turns out they're not the only people. They're not the only ones there. The colony has some survivors who kind of save the Steel Team's asses. And that is where the issue ends. Okay, so of course the questions now are, what happened to the egg? And how did these people survive? Moving on to our last book for a moment, we got Predator Number 3. Oh god, I cannot remember the friggin' name. Theta, our heroine, is pilfering a corporate base for supplies. Not so much abandoned as it apparently it's been attacked by Yautjas. And one attacks her, comes after her using her axe. But she manages to get away, but ends up taking a shot to the leg, which results in the loss of her leg. But she fashions herself a prosthetic. Does the necessary repairs to her ship. And, like I said, scrounges for supplies. Makes the repairs while drinking whiskey. And is about to leave the planet when a couple of Yautja ships arrive and open fire. Also, it turns out that the Yautja have added that planet to their hunting grounds, as her ship's been simply identified as being a corporate ship, so going after corporate facilities up for the corporation. And that is where the issue ends. So far, I'm liking this Predator book. Also, we get something of a definitive timeline for what counts, canonically speaking. Predator 2, Predators, and The Predator apparently count. Now, with The Predator counting, that also would mean that the AVP movies count, too. As there were the Otherworld Task Force did have the makeshift spear that the lead character from the first AVP movie had. Anyway, that is going to do it for now. As always, feel free to like, share, and subscribe. Links to my Facebook, Twitter, Patreon, and PayPal can be found in the description box down below. This is Rock and Roll Spock signing off, saying, live long and rock hard.